Welcome to the George Washington University School of Media and Public Affairs. My name is Kimberly Gross, and I am the acting director of the school. And I want to thank you all for joining us today for the latest installment in our conversation series, Inside the White House Briefing Room, a conversation with Jay Carney, White House Press Secretary. The conversation series is really sort of a special kind of set of events that we are able to do here, offering a personal look at Washington politics and media. As you'll see today, SMPA students and our GW community members have a chance to interact with our featured guests, as well granting them access to personalities and professionals that really they would get to interact with nowhere else. The conversation series is made possible by the philanthropy of our advisory board, the National Council on Media and Public Affairs, some of whom are in the audience today, and we thank them for their generous contributions, as well as the support of other parents, friends, and alumni of the school. I want to ask people to mark their calendars to join us for our next SMPA event, which is April 23rd, where we host the premiere of a new documentary looking at the events in Tiananmen Square, China's Tiananmen Square crisis. That documentary, Assignment China, Tiananmen Square, will include both a screening of the documentary and a conversation with two journalists who were there for that on the ground for those events. Today's event, just to let you know, is being live streamed on the internet, and video recording of the event will be up on our website within the next week. Audio from this event is going to be turned into a featured program later this year on Sirius XM Radio's program, This Just In, which is a program airing nationally on Sirius XM and on Federal News Radio. Now I have the privilege of introducing our two featured speakers for the day. Jay Carney is the 29th White House Press Secretary. He assumed this role in the winter of 2011 and has since served as the Obama administration's chief spokesperson through a variety of pretty big high-profile things, the government shutdown, the rollout of the Affordable Care Act, and international issues, including the current events in Ukraine. Major Garrett is the 2013-2014 SMPA Distinguished Fellow and also CBS News Chief White House Correspondent. Please join me in providing a warm GW welcome to Jay Carney and Major Garrett.
Jay, I must tell you, it's unfamiliar for me to look at you from this vantage point. I'm usually down here, usually
being
way up there.
Higher up,
yes, exactly. Well, thank you very much for having Jay and I come here, and we're going to have an informal conversation before all of you about White House press issues, Jay's transformation from being a journalist to being a spokesman, first for the vice president, now the president. And then at some point, we'll take questions from you. I want to instruct you, the methodology we're going to use is there'll be at the end of each row cards. You can write your questions down. They'll be funneled up to me here, and we'll take them that way. And welcome to our C-SPAN audience that's watching live. It is, as I said at the top, a privilege to be here. Jay, and I see you brought the magic briefing book. We'll get into that in a minute.
Yeah.
I just want to ask you, first of all, was it your aspiration ever as a journalist to do what you do now? And when you were presented with that opportunity, how did you weigh it? And do you think, having been a reporter, makes it more difficult or easier for you to do your current job?
So I'll start with the beginning of your question. No. I was a reporter, as you know, Major, for 21 years, 20 of them at Time Magazine. I loved being a reporter. My formative experience was as a correspondent based in Moscow for Time Magazine during the collapse of the Soviet Union. I had studied Russian in college. That was the advantage I had that sort of helped move my reporting career forward. And then I came to Washington in the mid-90s and covered President Clinton, Congress, President Bush, and had never really at all thought about serving inside of an administration, and certainly not in this job. But, you know, as you will find, life happens and serendipity occurs, and shortly after the election in 2008, the day after, in fact, a close friend of mine who was had been work, he was in a foreign policy foreign policy field. He had worked on in the NSC under Clinton and had been working on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee as the top staffer, Democratic staffer, and that meant working for Senator Joe Biden. So, you know, in the summer of 08, Biden is picked, they win. I'm talking to my friend, congratulating him the next day, and that was the first time the idea was put to me about coming in. And at the time, I thought perhaps, well, that would be kind of exciting and maybe something in the foreign policy arena, but it quickly became an opportunity to be the Vice President's Communications Director, which was obviously a huge change for me, but just a fantastic opportunity and a great decision, in part because, you know, I woke up every morning for probably 6 months wondering if I knew what I was doing and was cut out for the job, because I think what you think as a reporter covering the White House is you really understand, and you know, reporters do, how White Houses work, how communications works, how interaction with the media works from that side. And when you get on the other side, you find out that it's not quite as you imagined it, and that it's more complex than you realized, and that there's a lot to learn. And I had the great opportunity of, when I worked for the Vice President, in a job that wasn't like the one I have now, it's not a public job, a public spokesperson job, to learn under some, you know, with some great mentors, both folks who worked for the Vice President and who worked for President Obama. And then after 2 years, when the President was looking for another, second press secretary, you know, this happened, and it's been an extraordinary experience.
Does it make you better having been a reporter, or does that create hurdles for you in dealing with questions like press access, balancing what the White House tries to convey with our never-ending desire to be closer,
right,
more proximate to the President, and in some cases the Vice President?
Better or worse is for others to say. I think it makes me more aware of where reporters are coming from, having been there. I used to sit in the briefing room, and obviously, and then more broadly, covered politics, covered White Houses. So I have empathy, if not always sympathy. And it helps in the decisions that we make collectively, because it's not me. We have a team of people who, you know, kind of make decisions about press access and interviews, and also how we, you know, describe what we're doing as an administration and as a president.
Let me just stop you right there about the decision you made yesterday on an interview. It was an excellent decision.
Well, we're still reviewing whether that was such a wise choice, but.
Anyway.
I'm kidding. Yeah, if you don't know, Major was with us yesterday at an event the President did with Vice President Biden, which in of itself was pretty unique, and Major had an opportunity to interview the President at length, and then the two men together, which is something we actually hadn't done, so it was the first time. And that was at a community college outside of Pittsburgh, where the President was talking about an initiative that the Vice President is helping lead to make job training programs more job-focused and job-driven, and connecting community colleges and other academic institutions with businesses around the country so that we can maximize the potential of our people coming out of college so that they have the skills they need for the best and highest paying jobs.
You mentioned earlier that there are things that you learned once you were on the inside that you never appreciated or had any sense of when you were on the outside as a reporter. Can you give us an example of that?
Sure. I think the complexity of strategic communications probably was greater than I expected, and that there's just a lot more that goes into planning into the future about how you're going to roll out policies and talk about what you're doing and deal with all the incoming. I think when you're covering it, you sort of think about, and maybe this isn't true for you, but you just sort of think about that the communicators in a White House or administration or other institutions, just all they do is respond to questions, but there's a lot more to it than that. And so I learned a lot, and I have continued to learn a lot from some of the most competent and passionate people you'll ever encounter. And then I think just the diversity and complexity of the media. I definitely, as a representative of, you know, traditional national media organization in Time Magazine, was suffering from a myopic perspective, where I kind of had a very national media perspective and traditional media perspective on how the interaction between elected officials here in Washington and the rest, and especially national figures, and the rest of the country operated and should operate. And what we've found, for a couple of reasons, or what I've discovered, is that you know, people get their news in a variety of ways, and regional media is still hugely important. And any president or White House that doesn't pay great attention to that is missing a huge opportunity in terms of how you can reach Americans out there. And then also something that's happened explosively since President Obama took office, but was obviously happening before he took office, and which was part of his campaign in 08, is the diversification of media, the advent of social media, and how it drives news coverage and turns everything into kind of a warp speed interaction between event, coverage, reaction, and it I think makes the job I do and the job that our team does, you know, the communications team run by Jen Palmieri and the press office, you know, a lot different from what it was when I first covered a White House in President Clinton's first term, and even when I first, you know, the second time I came back and covered the White House in President George W. Bush's first term. The world has changed quite a lot.
Let me ask you about a couple things dealing with the social media aspect of communications for the president. You and the White House were very pleased with the Between Two Ferns interview with the president. Now, it would be historically inaccurate to suggest people who have run for the White House haven't done things of a similarly informal or conversational way. Richard Nixon was on Laugh-In as a candidate in 1968. Bill Clinton famously showed up on the Arsenio Hall show, played the saxophone, but that was as a candidate. Some people looked at that Between Two Ferns event and said, does the president see, as an institution, in any way become diminished with something that's kind of a send-up piece? It has a serious component, but there's also kind of a built-in comedic component to it. First question. The second one, yesterday, coming back from the event in Oakdale, Pennsylvania, the president and the vice president took a selfie in the back of the Beast, the presidential limousine. And that sort of suggests a kind of ubiquitousness of the president and this social media universe. Do you weigh any of those things as to oversaturating the public with the president, making him sort of this constant, unmissable presence on social media? And is that something you ever worry about, or is that something you try to drive? And talk to us about Between Two Ferns and how you probably anticipated the reaction you got from the sort of fuddy-duddy media, me, and what you actually found in the quote-unquote real world.
So on the first question, I think saturation would be a first-class problem that we don't have. The fact is that the president could come here today and give a speech covered by CBS, all the cables, everybody, and most Americans wouldn't even know it happened. It's just a fact. They certainly wouldn't consume it. They wouldn't see it. They wouldn't hear it. They might, if they watch the evening news, see 30 seconds of it. Maybe. Maybe. And you know how it works. Most speeches you guys don't even put on the evening news. And even the cables don't necessarily carry them live. So then, you know, they'll get covered maybe on the inside, if at all, in the major newspapers, regional. So, which is not a critique of the media. It's just, it's a statement of where we are and the media environment that we and anybody who's trying to break through has to deal with. So you have to find ways to communicate, to reach people. And when it came to the decision to do the Between Two Ferns show with Zach Galifianakis, I think we obviously look at ideas, and we have some crazy ones we don't take. And
please name one.
but I think there's an advantage to pushing the envelope, and I think that the
did they approach you, the White House, or did you approach them?
There was a conversation about wanting to help and do something. It was their idea. A handful of us presented it to the president, and I mean, he has a pretty good compass on his own and ability to judge what's right for him and But he also has faith in his team, and we knew there was some risk associated with it, but it was also a smart thing to do, because with the Affordable Care Act, this was about, I'm hoping that almost all of you saw it. The numbers would suggest you did. But the, we were trying to reach you. And that is more people watch Funny or Die and click on Between Two Ferns interviews than in your age group than watch the evening news or the morning shows. And it was an opportunity to get that message out and talk to young adults about the need to enroll in health insurance, the wisdom of having health insurance, the fact that none of you are invincible, though some days you probably feel like you are, because you don't have the aches and pains and creaks that Major and I do. But that obviously in retrospect, we all think it was a brilliant idea
because it
worked. And because we also have in the president
it worked
somebody.
In what metric?
There's no question it worked in terms of reaching people and getting a lot of views and clicks. We also have metrics that show that it drove a lot of direct traffic to healthcare.gov and contributed to what some of you may know was a huge surge in enrollment in March. That's you probably know less about that than you know how bad it was in October, but that's because good news doesn't get the kind of coverage that bad news does. So it worked, and it also worked because we asked the president because we knew he would be good at it, that he would, you have to understand when you're doing these things that, you have to have the right principal, if you will, somebody who can pull it off, and we were confident that he could, and he did. And obviously, the Zach and his team were fantastic in doing it. But what it wasn't and never was presented as was like an interview with the media. It's not, I remember we had some discussion during 2012 about, well, is it appropriate for the president, who's sitting president and candidate, to give interviews to Jon Stewart and others? And the answer was yes, again, because young voters that we were trying to reach are more likely to watch The Daily Show than some other news shows. But also, I think if you look back at 2012 and the series of interviews the sitting president of the United States gave, probably the toughest interview he had was with Jon Stewart. Probably the most substantive, challenging interview Barack Obama had in the election year was with the anchor of The Daily Show.
And what does that tell you?
I think you guys should all examine it and write about it. I think that. Well, that's a broader discussion about where the media is, traditional media are today. But it's also, I think, a reflection of the fact that that somebody like Jon Stewart is actually a very smart, sophisticated, both consumer of and presenter of the news. He just packages it in a way that draws eyeballs and young eyeballs, which is what we were looking for.
And the ubiquity on social media. I mean,
I wish we were ubiquitous.
What's the purpose? What are you trying to tell people with a selfie in the back of the presidential limo?
I think that it's no
it's
different.
It's cool
from,
to be us. Or?
Well, it's
which I'm sure it is.
I think that the purpose of that is the same as the purpose of. A photograph of the president and vice president that might have been released in the 1940s or 70s or 90s, and including a casual one as opposed to a stiff meeting. But it is translating that into the way that pictures are taken and distributed in 2014 as opposed to the way they used to be done. And I think it also was a great way to show, I wasn't even in the limo when they took the picture. It was like that moment captures their relationship, which is an amazing relationship. I mean, these are men of two different generations, obviously remarkably different backgrounds and experiences, who have forged a very powerful working relationship and partnership, but also a true friendship. And I think what appealed to me about that photo when I and others signed off on it was that it seemed so real.
Did you think for a moment about how Hillary Clinton might react to it?
No, not for a minute. Unlike the press, we don't spend a lot of time thinking about 2016 over down
the street
here.
I'm sure that's true.
talk to us about the briefing book.
Mm-hmm.
I will confess something that I'm sure other reporters have told you. Sometimes we feel that there is something less spontaneous when we're questioning you,
mm-hmm.
having you read from the briefing book, that we, as you know, we sometimes go back and forth at you to try to pull you out
sure.
of the contours of what's in the briefing book and do everything in our power, intellectually and persuasively in every other way, to get you off the talking points and to say something that's more revealing about what's happening within the building or within the administration.
How are you doing with that?
I'd say lukewarm yeah. success is probably the best I've ever achieved at that. How is that put together? Why do you sometimes have to stay within mm-hmm. those parameters? And do you ever flirt even momentarily with the notion of jumping outside the lines of what's in the briefing book?
Well, I'd say a few things about it. The briefing book exists because on any given day, this is yesterday's, I could be asked, this is just a compilation of subjects that I might be asked about based on what we're getting in terms of incoming questions during the day and what's newsy of the week, and there are probably 60 subjects here. So, I think I have pretty good retention, and yet I know that I'm not going to remember everything about what our policy positions are and all the latest incremental developments in a particular news area for 60 different subjects. So it's basically there for me to refer to if needed, if I get a question about the plane in Malaysia, but I haven't talked about it in a few days, and I don't. I may have had a brief verbal update on it in the morning, but there may be specifics about what kind of assets from the Defense Department we're deploying that I'm going to have to look in the book to find. So that
just
I can
to stop
say,
right there, you sort of have that exhaustive potential list kind of defensively, just so you are prepared.
Well, yeah, it's a matter of being
prepared. But there's
prepared.
There's a low percentage, I would imagine, of the things you have there that we actually ask about.
Well, I think, it depends 40%. On when you say the percentage. I'd say that, some days all of the questions are on subjects that are within here, but it could just be two subjects, right? You don't ask, the press, even though my briefings lasted close to an hour, they don't, if it's sort of a grab bag day and there's not anything or any subject or set of subjects that are just driving the news, I could get 20 different subjects in a briefing. But often, as was the case the day before yesterday, I think 80% of the briefing was Ukraine.
Right.
And in many ways, the same three questions on Ukraine just posed differently. And that's because Ukraine was driving the news. And so on the other thing about the talk, so there are subjects that, because they're alive every day, Affordable Care Act, sort of general economic issues and developments in them, Ukraine, that kind of stuff, I have, and I can speak very comfortably about in terms of discussing where the president is and new developments and what our objectives are. And you'll see that I'll, open the book less on things like that. If there are specific things that I need to say, and this can be especially true in the arena of national security, where the language sometimes has to be very precise, then I will, in order to be precise, consult the book. And that won't be everything I say on a subject, but there'll be an objective on a particular issue that I want to achieve. And the language can be, especially in foreign affairs, very important in terms of what you're telegraphing to allies or opponents, and what you're not. So that's one of the purposes that having a briefing book serves.
Let's go to one of the more recent mm-hmm. examples of that. Monday, we asked you about something that I think more than half of us didn't think you would necessarily be willing to confirm, that John Brennan, the CIA director, was mm-hmm. in Kiev. Typically, when we ask a question of that nature, we don't discuss the mm-hmm. travel plans of the CIA director and check with the agency and just a complete brush off. But internally, you made a decision to communicate that, to confirm it, and to push back on whatever Russian characterization had been made of that. Walk us through that process.
Well, it's true that we don't discuss the travel of the director of the CIA as a rule. In this case, it had been pretty well publicized that he had visited. So you do, in making decisions like this, sometimes say, we have to just go on the record conceding what everybody knows or acknowledging what everybody knows. But the broader purpose of doing that was to point out that the Russian response to that and attempts to use that as something that it wasn't needed to be knocked down, in the same way that so much of what Russian government officials have said lately about events on the ground in Ukraine has been fictional, fabricated, and of the kind of sort of heavy-handed propaganda that you used to see in a time long since passed in the Soviet Union. So that was the reason. It was out there. We needed to explain what it was and what it wasn't. I mean, heads of intelligence services, ours and others, meet and travel all the time to it was just another an opportunity to point out the distance between fact and reality that we were seeing out of Russian rhetoric.
But it was also meant to send a signal about our interest in what's going on there. You don't send the CIA director willy-nilly to places that are in the middle of a global foreign policy,
well,
potentially national security
certainly
crisis.
That's true, but we have we have cooperative relationships on national security issues, including intelligence issues, with many, many countries around the world. I think a more, in terms of the signal that our commitment to Ukraine's sovereignty, the symbol of that will be more powerfully, I think, than John Brennan's visit, will be the vice president's visit early next week. And that is certainly the purpose of that visit, to send the signal that we strongly support the Ukrainian government, we strongly support Ukraine's sovereignty and territorial integrity. As a representation of that, the vice president of the United States will be in Kiev next mm-hmm. week.
The relationship between President Obama and President Putin has been a long-running conversation long before this crisis in Ukraine exploded on the front pages. But today, Putin said the trust in that relationship broke down long before the disagreements over Crimea and Ukraine, and that there is essentially no relationship now of a fundamental working basis between the United States and Russia. How do you evaluate those comments? Do you believe the relationship broke down even before Ukraine, or that was, and in fact, should be viewed historically as a tipping point?
Well, there's no question that Russia's actions in Ukraine are of an entirely different order in terms of the severity of them and the opposition that they have brought from the United States and the rest of the world, compared to other things, although similar in many respects to Georgia. But the other disagreements that we have had, Syria, missile defense, and the like, have been challenges in the relationship between the U.S. and Russia, but this is obviously the most significant divide that we've seen in a long time. But I think that it is a simple fact that our relationship with Russia has always been one, or always in the recent past, been one of some cooperation and alongside significant disagreements. We have called out again and again and again now for 3 years Russia's appalling support for the brutal, homicidal Assad regime in Syria, its refusal to let United Nations Security Council resolutions pass that condemn what Assad is doing and would support the Syrian people. So, we didn't hide the ball on that at all. And haven't in any of the disagreements that we've had with Russia predating Ukraine. So I didn't see everything that President Putin said, but I think context here is important.
Let's talk about the Affordable Care Act for a minute. How grim was it for you when it became clear to you that all the briefings that we had received before the rollout of the healthcare website were in fact false, because we'd all been sort of treated to this behind the scenes assessment that there might be some glitches, but structurally it was sound. You find out it's not. You go through a week of saying, well, we're going to get our arms around this, but it becomes clear to you internally that it's not going to be a solvable problem in the near term. What was that moment like, and how did you have to adapt to what you knew was probably going to be a month, if not longer, of pointed questions, criticism, and that you were just going to have to, as the chief spokesman for the White House, take all that in?
Well, I say a couple of things. First of all, the briefings you got weren't false. They turned out to be
less than accurate.
Well, but it wasn't. What I'm contesting here is that the use of that word suggests that the people who were giving the briefing were misleading the press.
The people who gave
the briefing believed that the system was going to work with some glitches. Nobody expected, certainly among those who briefed the press on it, that we would see the severity, the kind of problems that we saw. So to answer your question, I mean, I think, as you recall, this was all happening concurrently with the shutdown of the government. So these were two major things happening at once. And then once the government reopened, it became quite clear, both internally and publicly, how significant the problems were with healthcare.gov. And look, I won't lie, that was probably one of the most difficult moments, I think, for not just me, but more importantly for everybody in the administration who worked on these issues, because this was something that was entirely on us, and it was our fault, if you will. We built the system. It was supposed to work far better than it did. It did not meet anything like the standards that were set for it, and therefore it was our responsibility from the president on down to get it right and to fix it. And so, that made this unique, because a lot of the kind of more challenging times that we face have to do with external events or bogus charges or things like that. This was something that we controlled. We didn't get right at the start, and that made it difficult, but all the more important that we get it right as soon as possible. And the president instilled that message to everyone, for the millions of people who were demonstrating by coming to the website that they wanted quality, affordable health insurance, but weren't able to get it because the website wasn't functioning, we owed it to them to fix it and get it right. And, it's a rather remarkable story, I think, of focus and perseverance by those who were on the team that fixed it, that we are where we are today, where, 7.5 million Americans enrolled in the marketplaces, despite the fact that we basically gave up 2 months at the beginning. So that's a good news story.
I have some sense of this, having covered the president as a candidate and this White House, but I'm sure you have a better sense of it. What is it about the president's approach to leadership and management of the White House that you gleaned from his decision not to fire anyone in the heat of that crisis, when many people, not just critics, but friends of the White House, allies of the president, thought it would be helpful both politically and as a sort of leadership tool to fire one or a number of people who are responsible for bungling this rollout?
Because the president was not and never is interested in the ephemeral satisfaction of being praised by his critics or friends. What mattered to him was fixing the problem. And
but he must have
ceremoniously
decided
that firing some people would have actually set back the cause of fixing the problem. The team that was responsible for healthcare.gov had a lot of expertise. They were added to by a surge of tech experts overseen by Jeff Zients, who was brought in for this purpose. Everybody felt responsible. Everybody rolled their sleeves up and got to work fixing the problem. And that was far more important than winning the news day by saying, the president fired somebody or some number of people. He's not into pointing fingers of blame. He's into results, especially in something like this, where the website was just a website. The website was merely a tool and is a tool to provide access to folks to quality, affordable health insurance. And, you know, we threw up enormous obstacles to people who wanted to avail themselves of that tool. And it was our responsibility to knock the obstacles down, make the website work. But it was just about fixing a website, not to diminish the size of the problem. It was significant. I should note, since we're here, that open enrollment is closed, and the period of open enrollment that was still open for those who were in line by the March 31st midnight deadline has now ended on April 15th. But some of you will be affected by this. It is still possible if you have a life-changing event, a graduation, a marriage, a birth, the loss of health insurance
bad
to
midterm,
enroll.
You know.
maybe this applies to graduate students here, you know, because of the Affordable Care Act, if you're 26 or under, you can stay on, even as an adult, stay on your parents' insurance policy. But once you age out, once you get old and turn 27, you're responsible for your own health insurance, and that is an event that would mean that you're able to enroll even when open enrollment is over, as it is now. So keep that in mind, and if you're one of those people, I urge you to go to healthcare.gov.
I want you to recall your days as a reporter. You and I covered a lot of events together. You were a competitor. And a very good one. You know the zeal that reporters pursue stories. You know the satisfaction that comes from that, oh, I've got them now moment, or something approximating that. And you probably, as a reporter, would have looked at PolitiFact identifying if you like your plan, you can keep it as the political lie of the year quite differently than you do now. Reporters look at that and say, yeah, it seems about right. For you, in this second role of your life, you view that differently. Talk to me about the political lie of the year, if you think it's fair, and if you were a journalist, would you view it differently than you do as a spokesman for the White House?
Well, I view a lot of things differently in this job because I come at these things with a different perspective. I think that on that particular issue, I think that a lie is one of intent, and the president believed that that's what the policy would deliver, and when it didn't, and it became clear that it wasn't, and that there were things that needed to be fixed to help those individuals, which according to Rand is now somewhere under a million people total in the whole country, that it ought to be done. I'm not gonna, you know, obviously not every story, not every item out there is one that, you know, we think is accurate or fair, but as a rule, coming from the press, and I recognize that there are a lot of serious reporters out there who do really good work, even if I don't agree with every story they write or broadcast.
Talk to me about how you believe the media has changed just in your time in government.
Mm-hmm.
And do you worry, does any administration worry about either the contraction of the media, how it is changing, if the traditional forms that previous White Houses used to rely upon, the evening news or the major newspapers, is less important? You talked a moment ago about regional media. Anyone who's been in my business knows that many once very strong regional newspapers have shrunk dramatically. Mm-hmm. Coverage is different. How do those things strike you from the government's perspective, from a White House perspective, and do you have any concerns about how the media is changing and what it means for any White House to communicate with the country?
So there are a variety of ways of looking at this question, and I think that as a citizen, I am concerned about some of the transformations that we've seen in the media over the last 5 or 6 years, and the last 10 or 15. A lot of major news organizations that used to cover the world don't anymore. They don't have people overseas. They don't have the bureaus that they used to have even in the country. And I think, we are all poorer for that. I think that...
You saw that in time.
Sure, absolutely. And that, I mean, that's a direct result of the financial pressures on the media that were particularly severe 2007, 2008, 2009. I mean, I think thanks to the fact that we avoided a depression, the president did, and put the economy on the right track again so that we've been growing and creating jobs now. The media have benefited from that turnaround as well. We're not nearly where we need to be economically yet, but we're on a far better trajectory. All that to say is that that kind of crisis atmosphere financially for the mainstream media isn't nearly as severe as it was 5 years ago. So I think that's a problem. I think that, there are different baskets here. I think a generally very positive and world-changing potentially development is social media when it comes to the ability for anybody to have access to information that they couldn't even have imagined having access to just 5 or 10 years ago, and that's true in the United States, but very importantly, it's true in countries around the globe, including in repressed in countries where they experience political repression, and that makes it much more challenging for oppressive regimes to try to control their citizenry, and that's obviously a positive thing. And we've seen how that can affect and transform societies in a positive way. What it has also done, and I think we talked about this earlier, the sort of hyperspeed of the news cycle that we live in now, is that few things last for very long. That can be good or bad from our perspective. Something that seems like a big, one of the things that I do every day and that we do as a team in the White House is we see all the incoming and we monitor Twitter and we see what, and we have to decide fairly quickly certainly much more quickly than our predecessors did about, what merits a reaction and what doesn't. And part of it is predicting when this thing is gonna burn out, whatever it is. And often, as I think my colleague Dan Pfeiffer said recently, the fires burn brightly, but they also burn out faster. And so it's basically.
Is that convenient for you?
Well, it can be good and bad. Like I said, it can mean that a great deal of attention on something very positive, if we get attention on something very positive, can dissipate very quickly, as well as a story that's not as good. But I think that for us, it means having some judgment and perspective about and resisting the impulse to react or overreact to something that seems like it's becoming a big deal or blowing up on social media. And sometimes just knowing when we need to jump in, either through Twitter or through a statement or all the different means we have, mm-hmm. going up to a presidential statement, or to wait and see what it's actually going to turn out to be.
I want to let people know, yep. if you want to bring the questions up, I'll take some now so we can get that process started. But you're touching on something that I experience at the White House, and I wonder if you would agree that when you and I came to Washington in the early 90s, there was a common phrase, you probably have either read about it or heard it, the great question for an emerging story, would it have legs? And there was a sort of a tidal force to something building up momentum and then holding space on the front page of the New York Times, the Washington Post, the networks, and so on and so forth. Is that less a concern now, that tidal surge and a story getting legs, because things have this spike-like quality that's driven by sort of an ask and response on social media, where it can rise and fall literally within the course of a morning or an afternoon?
I guess less of a concern if you mean,
as you look at it from...
You mean in terms of sort of legs, like a problem story, I potentially, but you sometimes stories do have legs, even in this environment, and they last longer than a few hours or a few days. But I think but that's also, again, I think there's, this is a double-edged sword, because that means that also makes it more and more challenging for us to, keep stories, alive about, what the president's agenda is and what he's trying to do and what we think are positive developments or important developments, whether they're good or bad. I think that another problem that we have is that there is, because of this sort of ratcheting up in the action and reaction cycle that we see, especially on Twitter and other forms of media and cable, you have stories that build to, huge proportions really quickly, and then, you know, I think there's a temptation in the media to label everything a scandal or a gate this or a gate that, and I would simply point back to a year ago now, and the three stories that consumed the presidency and were the focus of a great deal of minutes on broadcasts about how potentially damaging they were, are not the subject of anything or much coverage now at all, because they ended up not being what they were reported to be. And that, you know, obviously I'm talking about, some of the issues that Republicans tried to say were scandals but weren't. And there was, for us, we just have to, focus on getting out the information as quickly as we can and sort of, muscling through that kind of static.
To take that point, isn't that how the process works? Issues are raised, hard questions are posed, you deal with them, and then there's a sorting out of what is or what isn't. I mean, that process...
No, but what has changed is that within an hour, you get people on TV, on cable TV, saying the whole presidency... Yeah, I can't tell you how many times the presidency has been at stake since I've been in press secretary. You know, like teetering on the balance, and...
I've never said that.
And
I've never written that. Jay knows that.
So I'm just saying that there's that sort of intensity that... social media and the current sort of structure of the media contributes to and makes worse. I'm not saying it didn't exist in the past, mm-hmm. and that there weren't stories that ended up not having legs and getting that knocked down in the past. Certainly that's true. It's just there's a race to the top or the bottom, depending on how you look at it.
I've had a chance to look at these. They're great, and we're going to start off with a very light one. What's your favorite place to eat in D.C.?
The White House mess. Give a shout out to the wonderful people in the U.S. Navy who run on the.
Where, for the record, I've never been invited to eat.
You're not allowed to eat. You're not allowed to eat.
Not at sea.
But I could bring you a burger if you came to my office.
That's quite all right.
That and my kitchen with my kids.
Got it.
It's true.
This is on C-SPAN. He knows what he's doing. This I'm sure I'll see many times, so I'll ask it once. What advice would you have for a GW student who wants your job in 30 years? Shorten it to 20 years spectrum, you know.
Yeah. I think I ended up in the position I'm in not in a traditional way and not imagining that I would end up there, so I'm not sure I'm the right person to ask, whoever asked. But if you're interested in policy and politics, then you ought to get involved in policy and politics. And I think that...
But you weren't. You
right, so I'm saying that I'm the wrong person. Like, I wouldn't say go become a news magazine journalist and see what happens, but...
just roll the dice.
I think that... But look, I mean, one of the things that has been enormously gratifying about sort of my life change and career change has been that that I joined a team that had the reputation of being insular and turned out to be anything but, and that took me in and taught me a lot, and I have made really, really strong friendships and have learned an enormous amount from people who have been doing this kind of work for a lot longer than I have, and with whom I would work and struggle and fight on a lot of different fronts in the future, because they believe in what they're doing and they're there for the right reason and they're enormously talented. So, we all develop cynicism in this profession, and I mean the sort of political journalistic sphere, not just on my side of the divide. And I think it's important to remember that, we're not doing this or we shouldn't be doing this for any other reason than to help people and help make the country better. And that's what I see. I think people ask me, what's been the most surprising thing about being on the inside? And the surprising thing to me has been, from the beginning, how human it is, how human an enterprise it is, how in the end it is a handful of people sitting with the President of the United States trying to help him and inform him and to discuss with him as he has to make some incredibly difficult decision. And it's, and people are there giving him the best advice they can and doing it from the, for the right reasons and from the right place. And it may not always lead to the right answer, but I think that I walk away, when I walk away from this, I will walk away from this with a lot of reaffirmation and faith in the capacity of people to come to Washington and do the best they can for all the right reasons.
Has the vice president ever given you a nickname?
I don't think so.
You'd know, I suspect.
Yeah, no, I mean, I have a very good relationship with the vice president and am hugely grateful to him for taking me on. And he's one of the most decent and big-hearted and wise individuals you'll ever find in politics. And, you know, what I admire about him, and I saw it yesterday, is that, you know, he's been doing this for a long time, and he brings to it a passion and energy that, you know, if some of you go into politics, you'll be lucky to match at 22 or 23. And that's really, you know, he's not somebody who cashed in or got too cynical to make a difference. He's been the opposite of that, and I think he's a great public servant.
Have you ever knowingly deceived the American public? If so, was it justified?
The answer to that's no, and I have not. And look, I think that credibility is important, and a lesson I learned very early is that when you're asked a question to which you don't know the answer, you don't guess. You say, I don't know, and I'll get back to you. If you're asked a question that you cannot answer for national security reasons or other reasons, you don't mislead, you simply don't answer. Or you say forthrightly, as I have to you in the podium, you know, like, I can't discuss that. I'm not going to discuss covert programs or something like that. So I think that that doesn't mean, as is the case with the PolitiFact thing you mentioned, that, you know, something I said or anyone else I work with who's out there speaking on the record said didn't turn out to be wrong. But that's different from intentionally saying something that's wrong.
Is the flak jacket a real press secretary tradition? If so, what have you learned from it?
It wouldn't stop much. It's more, there is a flak jacket, but it's like a dress flak jacket. It's not the kind you would see in theater.
Got it. Two on the West Wing. What's your favorite episode, and who is your favorite character?
Well, got to say CJ, right?
And I would think so.
Who is fantastic, and whom I actually don't know. I know some of the folks. Brad Woodford, who played Josh Lyman, is a terrific person. We did a thing that you may remember for the Big Block of Cheese.
Big
Day,
Block of Cheese, video, I do remember that.
I did with Josh Molina and Brad Woodford. And but I have to say, I had a friend who wrote for The West Wing, and there were two episodes. There's one in which there's constant references to a Congressman James Carney, which is my friend's way of, this is years ago, friend's way of inserting me into an episode. And then another one where, if you remember, anybody who watches the show, where the reporter is going to go to jail because he won't testify or divulge something, and he's talking to CJ, and he says, I'm just, I get choked up, but, because when you have kids, you'll know. He goes, well, I'm just really worried about Della, and that's my daughter's name.
Right. So. Very good. Here's a question that we hear in the briefing with some frequency. So because it's a complete parallel universe, I'm going to ask it. Will President Obama sign an executive order banning federal contractors from engaging in employment discrimination against LGBT Americans?
So this I'll be able to do without consulting my book.
And if so, why hasn't he done it yet?
As you know, Major, the president strongly supports action taken by the Senate to pass the Employment Non-Discrimination Act. And he urges the House to follow suit. Those who oppose this legislation are profoundly on the wrong side of history. and will be seen as such in a very short time if they don't already feel it. That's what the president believes. That's certainly what I believe. And I just don't, as is the case with any prospective or speculated about executive order, I don't have anything for you on that today.
Understood. The Obama administration came to Washington promising transparency. In your view, has the administration fallen short of this goal? Also, can you update us on the status of the White House Correspondents Association? I did not write this. A complaint regarding journalist and photographer access to the president. We can probably both deal with that question.
Transparent. Yeah, look, I think there is no question. I've covered two, the previous two administrations, and know a thing or two about ones before that. There's never been a more transparent administration.
That does not mean
that we provide more information about, for example, the WAVES records, something that no administration has ever
explain done. Explain what the WAVES records
are. The WAVES records are the records collected by the Secret Service of individuals who are cleared in for meetings in the White House. And those have never been released before. No administration has ever released them. And I think it's fair to say that the release of that information has made this White House far more transparent than any other White House. That doesn't mean it's perfectly transparent. And it also, that creates headaches for us, right? I mean, and ridiculous stories on Fox News and elsewhere about, for example, well, the WAVES records show that Hillary Clinton was only in the White House, five times, whereas Secretary so-and-so was there this many times. Well, people like Hillary Clinton and most cabinet secretaries literally get waved in by the Secret Service. They're not entered into the logs. Secretary Clinton, as her successor is in the White House every week. Was in the White House every week. And so it leads to some challenges because those records weren't devised for to be a complete picture because of the way that individuals who are part of the administration enter and depart the White House. But they provide a lot more information about who visits the White House than has ever been provided before. And in a variety of different ways, we give, we provide a lot more information than's ever been provided before, which doesn't mean we or any White House is ever going to be able to be completely transparent. And this, in some ways, blends with the other question. It is absolutely the case today and will always be the case, as it has always been the case, that the White House press corps will not be satisfied with the level of access it has to the president or the rest of a president's team. And the reason why it will never be the case is because there will always be meetings. There will always be a limit on the number of interviews or press conferences, meetings that the press is not a part of, because it's simply impossible for any president or any White House to function otherwise. But the press should keep pressing for more access. That's absolutely the right thing to do and the responsible thing to do. And when we get into debates about levels of access that this White House has given compared to previous ones, I like to cite that President Obama's given more than two times as many interviews as his immediate predecessor, George W. Bush, and significantly more even than Bill Clinton at this stage in his presidency. He's given more full-blown, stand-up, hour-long plus press conferences than President George W. Bush. So, which doesn't mean that you guys should be satisfied and think, oh, well, we're getting enough, because you absolutely are doing your jobs by asking for more.
I'll get to the numbers in a minute, but for those of you who don't know, I'm on the White House Correspondents Association board, and so I've been part of the conversations that we have been having with the White House. Jay has been a part of almost every single one of them. And I want to just bring up for this audience something that I know you have a perspective on, and we certainly have a perspective on. It's not limited to photographic access to the president, but this sort of dovetails with our earlier conversation about social media and the flexibility it gives any White House and will give every future White House to use the immediate mechanism of social media photography or photography moved to social media to sort of work around those who are in the building every day. Whether you're streaming something live that we're not there for, or you have your White House photographer shoot something that the White House press corps is not present for, you can pump that out, and that becomes a kind of declarative statement or image of the White House that we're not involved in. And we obviously chafe against that, not just professionally, but from a matter of principle, which I know you can understand. How do you measure those things, and do you find yourself likely to come more in our direction and giving us more entree to those events that had for a while been much more White House photographer driven?
So I'm sure that most of you haven't followed this in the, to the degree of detail that Major and I have, but I here's how I'll put it. What we do is use tools that we and all of you have that did not exist in previous White Houses, Flickr accounts and Twitter and Instagram. And every White House after us will do that. And they'll the next White House and the one after that will have tools available to it, as will most of you and others, that we can't even imagine when it comes to distributing information. It would be malpractice not to take advantage of those tools. Fundamentally, we'll start with photographs. When we release a picture taken by the White House photographer or one of the White House photographers online, we're doing nothing different from actually what our current chief White House photographer did when he was President Reagan's White House photographer, which was back then he would make prints and hand them out in the briefing room. The difference is those prints would be delivered to news organizations who would then decide whether to publish them. But now, because of the internet, we can put them online and you all get to see them. It's not up to the AP or CBS or others to decide whether you get to see them. I understand that that creates tensions, and I'm hugely sympathetic to the financial pressures that are on media organizations. But I think there was an interesting exchange over a recent dispute about photographer access where a reporter said she would have been fine with no press coverage of this event if we hadn't released a White House photo, which is a weird way to talk about transparency. It's like, so if our reporter wasn't allowed in there, our photographer wasn't allowed in here, then nobody should see the event. I don't think that's good for the American people. So, and I think consumers out there can judge for themselves whether, what to make of a picture that is taken by a White House photographer versus somebody from the independent press. But they're not substitutes for one another. All we're doing is doing what previous White Houses have done, but we're actually using tools that are available to us that weren't available before. But having said that, and I know that because you and I have worked closely on it, I and everybody else on our team is committed to trying to do as much as we can to expand access, and we've done that to some degree, and we're going to continue to try to do that.
And we're going to continue to press for that. On the numbers question, the ones you cite about interviews are verifiable, easily verifiable. That's the president's preferred form of communication. Other presidents were more willing to have...
Well, you forgot that he has given more full-length press conferences than his
president. No. There's another dimension of presidential communication mm-hmm. that you experienced and that I experienced and that I wish we would see more of. And I want to ask you about the president's thoughts on this. Having in any one of these pool spray situations where the president's with a cabinet or a foreign leader or any event, taking one or two questions on the news of the day, mm-hmm. which interferes necessarily and by definition with whatever you're trying to drive and what you've worked very carefully behind the scenes for a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks trying to push out there. He seems less comfortable with that. Your team seems less comfortable with that. Bill Clinton did a lot of those things, one or two questions. George W. Bush did them. Why, and of course, for anyone who's in the building every day as a reporter, that's what we crave the most, the chance to put the question of the day, whatever the news is, to the president and get his reaction. That seems to happen less often, and statistically, it's clearly less frequent mm-hmm. than with Clinton or Bush. Why is that?
Well, first of all, it's not a matter of comfort, at least on our part. The president's comfortable doing it, comfortable taking questions from the press, just as he was with you yesterday. I think if you turn it around, especially with some of the president's predecessors, you have to decide what, or I think it's worth looking at what benefit is greater. When the president stands up and takes multiple questions for many hours, allowing follow-ups or hours over a certain amount of time, and I think that I would be willing to go head-to-head with past presidents on the number of minutes this president has spent answering questions from the free press compared to the number of minutes in his presidency that his predecessors have, and I think we've come out pretty well. And what a longer press conference and a substantive interview allows is a reporter to actually dig deep and press and follow up, whereas the news of the day, I know it feeds the beast, right? And that I know that's what, and that's an important thing, and I know that's what folks who cover the White House on a daily basis need that day. But I'm not sure that, I mean, what it does allow for any president, and you might suggest one of the president's predecessors preferred that mode because it allowed just this, it allows for a quick answer and then the pool's out of the room and the president, there's no follow-up, there's no pressing, there's no depth to the exchange. So, you know, we make decisions all the time. President's going to have a lot of encounters with the press and multiple foreign leader press conferences on his trip to Asia that begins next week. So, you know, it's all about balancing the most valuable commodity we have, at least in the communication sphere, which is the president's time.
As you can see, lots of questions here. I'll try to move through them. How do you deal with the ethical dilemma of having to profess and defend policies or ideological stances that you might personally disagree with? Has that ever happened?
No. I mean, I'm not a policy expert in all the fields that a president or administration has to work in. So I can't say I have sophisticated opinions about every policy that we've pursued, but I have been completely supportive personally of all of the major things that this president has done, and that clearly makes it easier to do my job. Having said that, you know, everyone who serves a president has to decide for himself or herself what, you know, why you're there and what, you know, what greater interest you're serving and purpose you're serving. Because if you're an expert in an arena of foreign policy or domestic policy, and there are obviously heated debates that there should be inside about which course of action should be taken, which policy is the better approach. And so not everybody around the table is going to get what he or she wants. And, you know, I think that's the way the process should work. But if you don't get 100% of what you want around the table, I don't think that means you get up and leave because you want to contribute to the process.
A very direct question, cuts right to the heart of things. How can I get a job with you or your staff? Whoever wrote that has got a promising future.
Yeah. These are obviously sought after.
Tackle him after the event.
Sought after jobs. We have internships. There's a White House internship program that you can find on whitehouse.gov. And, you know, otherwise, there's, you know, send your resume.
It's a good one. Have you ever met spokespersons from other countries, prime ministers, presidents? Any experiences of working together with them, stories? How different or similar are their jobs from yours? That's not a bad question.
That's a good question. I've met a lot of great people who are spokesmen or women for other leaders. It depends on the country whether how similar the job is. I don't know that there are that many where there's a press secretary or spokesman who's giving briefings every day. Although I found some where there are more regular briefings of the kind that we have. But it's very interesting. And when I usually have these encounters when we're traveling and the president's going to have a press conference with a foreign leader, and my counterpart and I, you know, trade notes about what to expect and what order the questions will come in, because it'll be I'm thinking most recently when we were in the Netherlands and mm-hmm. With my Dutch counterpart, and she was, you know, sort of saying, here's what our press is probably interested in, and, you know, protocol has, I guess, the visiting leader go first and the host leader go second, so those kinds of things. But, you know, I think one thing that's a little difficult or challenging for our counterparts is that when you have a president of the United States taking questions with another leader, there's sometimes an eagerness on the part of the other press corps, the foreign press corps, to ask our president questions, as well, of course, our White House press corps asking our president questions. And so sometimes, the other leader standing next to the president is spending a lot of time listening to the U.S. president answering questions, which can be a little awkward.
Is that a little delicate?
It's not delicate. I mean, I think that it's just...
Would you have to massage that either before or after the event?
Not really. I think it's useful for our press, and Major, I think you've done this, is that it's good to hear the perspective of a foreign leader on some of these things and the issues that are at stake and that the two countries may be working on together or may have a conflict over. So I think that kind of only go for the U.S. president can lead to, sort of less interesting press conferences.
I'm going to ask one on my own and get back to these. Did you have a ambivalent reaction when you saw that the Washington Post and the Guardian won a Pulitzer for the NSA coverage provided in large measure by information leaked to them by Edward Snowden?
Our views on Mr. Snowden haven't changed. And
I ask your view.
Yeah.
Because you've walked in both places.
I think I'll... refrain from, commenting on each individual award. Obviously, they're prestigious awards, and my view on in general is that, the best of those awards, go to reporters who break new ground through the shoe leather reporting of the past, and who develop sources, who find information, who devote hours and days and weeks and months to getting a story right. And I think that, year after year, you see in the Pulitzers and other similar awards, work held up that meets those standards.
Here's a really easy one. Would the White House support Kathleen Sebelius if she ended up running for public office?
Well, we don't speculate on the candidacies that are only speculated about. So I would... wait to see who's going to run in any individual race. The president, I think, spoke very clearly the other day about Secretary Sebelius and the dedication she showed through a remarkable period of change that she helped bring about. She's been in the hot spot for a long time, not just because of the healthcare.gov challenges, but through the development of the legislation, the incredibly fraught period when the legislation was passed and through its implementation. So the president truly appreciates her service.
Which former press secretary do you consider to be a model for the job that you do?
They're all great.
How much consulting did you do with them before you took the job, before you moved from vice president to vice?
I spoke with every living predecessor. Or tried to. I think there was one I couldn't reach. But
was there a singular thread of powerfully important advice?
To answer the first question, partly because of when I came in to cover the White House. I mean, I've always admired Mike McCurry and Joe Lockhart, Marlon Fitzwater, who was President George H.W. Bush's press secretary, as well as Reagan's last press secretary, was exceptional. What each of those press secretaries would tell you is that the world has changed tremendously. But one of the things that Mike McCurry, he was Bill Clinton's press secretary, his second one. One thing that I think Mike has told each of his successors, or said to each of his successors, is that he apologizes for having been the press secretary who agreed to allow the briefing to be broadcast in full on television, because prior to that decision, the White House daily briefing was only broadcast for the top 10 or 12 minutes was on air, and then the cameras would be turned off. And that was just so that TV correspondents could get what they need on the news of the day at the top, and then the rest of the briefing was off camera. And I think it's fair to say, and I experience this every week when I travel, the difference in tenor and sort of combativeness that you see and almost theatricality that you see between briefings that we have in the briefing room in the White House that are on camera versus the ones I do when we travel on Air Force One with just the press pool is stark. And I think that's partly because folks in the briefing room are aware that the camera's on, and it becomes a little more of a performance on everyone's part.
I have no idea what he's talking about.
Some people have noted that when a press secretary goes to all the TV correspondents, sometimes they ask the exact same question that the previous TV correspondents ask. And what I say in defense of them, although that can be frustrating for someone like me, is that each of them, you know, they may need that for their piece, right? And so, you know, I understand why it often happens. But when you don't get sort of what's happening and you're watching, you're like, why is that person asking the same question that the woman down the row asked? Well, that's why.
And you know,
or it's because, as Major said, they're just going to keep asking the same question until I
try to pry something loose. Yeah.
Right.
This is a question from someone who not only obviously watches the White House briefings, but also watches the State Department briefings. State Department daily press briefings tend to feature more confrontation between reporters and the press secretaries, Marie Harf and Jen Psaki. Is there a different expectation of decorum or respect for White House press
briefings?
That's
interesting. I didn't know that was the case. And but I know that Jen and Marie are up to the challenge. I don't think so. I think that, you know, we've had our contentious days in the White House briefing room. I think that, you know, I think that
State Departments tend to be more granular, for sure.
Right. There's a level of expertise on narrower subject matters that you can find in a State Department briefing. You know, I think that for the most part, people have a sense of where they are, that there's at least a minimum level of decorum that ought to be embraced. You're in the West Wing of the White House, and that's a pretty special place to be for everyone, those of us who work there and reporters who work there.
One of my favorites. Do you watch Scandal? Is B613 real?
Okay, I have a confession to make. I have got to watch Scandal. I haven't seen it yet. I have watched House of Cards, which is excellent and fun to watch.
But, especially the last episode this year.
I am catching up, so don't say that.
When you get to it, you'll understand why I just said
that. Yeah. So, you know, I have a lot of things I need to watch and read at some point when I have a little more time.
This one is from someone who might also be a psychology student. Describe yourself in three sentences without talking about your role in the White House or previous journalism positions. I'm just a messenger, Jay.
I'm a husband and a father of two and a proud native of Virginia.
And a Boston Red Sox fan.
And a Boston Red Sox
fan. I'll throw that in there because I've seen that. Very good. What is the best way to think on your feet and field a tough question? How did you have to teach yourself how to do that? Or did the fact that you asked tough questions before give you a particular capability that maybe others
Well, it gave me some experience. Now, and also as a reporter, I had, even though I was a print reporter, I had done it some roundtable talk shows and TV, and so I had some experience with that. But it is a different thing entirely. I mean, what is true is that when you go on a Sunday show as a reporter and you say something that turns out to be completely wrong, nobody really cares and nobody holds you accountable. It's not that way when you're the press secretary. So it took a little. It takes practice. And what you know, when I was named press secretary, there was a 2.5 week or 3 week gap between that day and the day I actually briefed for the first time. And during that period, I was benefited greatly from some mock press conferences that I had, briefings that I had with staff and some others who helped. And that really, including my predecessor, you know, Robert Gibbs, who knew from personal experience just the kind of question to ask that would completely unsettle me. So,
you mentioned a moment ago there are things you have to read and watch. I want to ask you about the pace of the job.
Mm-hmm.
And does it ever come near to, if not breaking you, wearing you down? And can you describe the tension of a position like yours, or any senior position in any White House, in relationship to the life you're actually trying to conduct as a husband, as a father, and as a normal human being?
Sure. Look, these are demanding jobs, but they're wonderful jobs to have. And there's not a person I know who works in the White House who doesn't feel anything but lucky to be there. And but it's tough on family. I think the sort of trade-off that I made was that everything else got put aside. I have a really close friend who lives in Washington. I'm sure I have not seen him this calendar year yet. And but we email once in a while, get on the phone. So I make a point of doing my job to the best of my ability, and that requires a lot of hours on the road and in the office, but then making as much time as I can to be there for my family. What that means is sort of everything else, like movies and books and friends, gets put on hold. But I think it's a challenge for everyone who does the job, and not just those of us with kids, but for everyone, whether they have kids or not.
What are your thoughts on new projects like Ezra Klein's Vox.com or 538 or some mm-hmm. of these other platforms that take where reporters or a collection of reporters who believe they have created a brand identity is sufficient to make themselves commercially independent from either where they started in the New York Times or the Washington Post? Do you think that is something that is going to become more prevalent, or do you, as some media critics wonder, if there's any kind of business model beneath that?
Well, I'm not sure I'm a good judge of what will succeed commercially, but I do greatly appreciate that kind of development, because in the two examples you gave, these are efforts to go broad and deep on issues and policies and subjects in a way that you often don't see or get through traditional mainstream media, or even a lot of the new media, which can be almost by definition, if we're talking about Twitter, short and to the point and superficial, because how much can you really say in 140 characters? So I think explanatory journalism is hugely valuable. I mean, I think, no matter how steeped in the news you may be, and you and I are as steeped as one can be, there are going to be subjects where you read the newspaper in the morning and, the story starts with what happened yesterday in a subject that's been going on for a long time, and you may not know the backstory, and you're not going to get it from the story that you read that day. And some of these sites are, because of the infinite capacity of the internet, are able to, in a few clicks, bring you up to speed in a way that is uniquely possible with the internet. So I think that's a good thing. Can they succeed on their own? I don't know.
We have one more question that I'll get to for a minute, but I want to have one of my own before we wrap it up. You mentioned a while ago there were three stories about a year ago that took on, from your perspective, an outsized importance as compared to what they actually were. One of them was obtaining records of reporters and either prosecuting sources who had talked to reporters. Numerically, this administration has done that more than its predecessors. Do you feel that's a legitimate issue? Do you feel comfortable defending the administration's approach to tracking down those leaks and trying to create a prosecutorial trail that may or may not touch reporters? Where do you come down on that application of the power of the federal government and journalism?
Sure. Well, on the broader subject, I think that some of the shorthand is misleading when it comes to the number of active investigations or prosecutions into leaks. The fact is, a number of them were inherited from the Bush administration, and imagine what would have happened if a new president had come into office and either he or his attorney general had ended investigations into national security leaks. There's that. On the second, and then on the issue of the press, I think I could point you to, as I know you're aware, the things the president has said and the attorney general has said about their concern about the need to provide greater protections for the press, and that no reporter, I'm quoting the president, should be prosecuted for doing his or her job. That's absolutely the president's view. On the flip side, and this is separate from reporters at least directly, you know, we as a country, and I think reporters also specifically need to decide when they talk about this issue and frame it in a way that makes it seem like the only issue here is press freedom and the ability of the press to do its job, whether or not it should be against the law to divulge classified information. Because if it shouldn't be, then we shouldn't have classified information and we shouldn't have secrets. Now, think about that and whether that's even possible for any government to function
effectively. Has your thinking on that evolved since you come into government?
Yeah, I think I've become more sensitized to the damage that can be done by leaks of classified information. I mean, the president has spoken on the issue of the disclosures that have come out of the NSA story. That, you know, the debate that has been intensified because of those disclosures is a very important debate to have. And the reviews that it spawned have been very important, and they've led to significant changes already instituted by the president, ordered by the president. But there is also no questioning the fact that harm has been done to our national security interests. And, you know, you can't be dismissive of that. That's real. And it involves our ability to, not this administration's, but the government's ability to keep Americans safe, to achieve objectives that are very important in the national security arena towards not just keeping Americans safe, but our allies safe. So there are costs.
We are at 11:30. The last question, and I want the person who wrote it down to raise your hand. The question goes like this. Can I have a selfie with you? I promise it's not a Samsung device. I'm the cute blonde in the middle of the... I'm sorry. How did I jump to that? I don't know. Anyway, she's right there.
Absolutely.
Jay Carney,
okay.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
It's been a great pleasure.